Good morning, students. Yesterday we discussed Hilbert's width theorem related to the symmetric kernels, and today we will discuss the consequences of this theorem. So the first consequence of Hilbert's width theorem is the bilinear form for the mth iterative kernel. We already obtained the bilinear form for the given kernel, which is symmetric, in this form, which is given by summation m varies from 1 to n phi m s into phi m conjugate t divided by lambda m. Now today, in the form of consequences of the theorem, we will find such kind of form for the mth iterative kernel. Now by definition, mth iterative kernel km, that is given by integral k sx into km minus 1 xt dx. Now this mth iterative kernel can be written in the form of the equation as we discussed in Hilbert's width theorem, f is equal to kh. Comparing this equation with this form, we get the function h given by km minus 1 xt. Here t is fixed, km minus 1 is m minus 1th iterative kernel. Now according to Hilbert's Smith theorem, if the function f can be represented in this form, then there exists an expansion of this function f in the form of absolutely and uniformly convergent Fourier series. So here we can find uniformly and absolutely convergent Fourier series for the function km. So according to that theorem, mth iterative kernel kmst, that can be written in the form of Fourier series given by summation k varies from 1 to infinity ak t into phi ks. Here this ak, these are the Fourier coefficients of this mth iterative kernel with respect to the system of eigenfunctions, which we already denoted by phi k, and these are the eigenfunctions of the given symmetric kernel kst, and these are given by ak is equal to inner product of km with phi k. Now by definition of inner product, this is given by integral of product of this function with the conjugate of phi k. Now using the property of symmetric integral equation for the functions, eigenfunctions phi k conjugate and the eigenvalues lambda k raised to the power m, the symmetric integral equation is satisfied. So from there we can find this value which is given by phi k conjugate divided by lambda k raised to the power m, which can be written in this form. So we have obtained the value of Fourier coefficients. Now we can substitute the values of Fourier coefficients in the Fourier series as we written by the equation star. Substituting the value of Fourier coefficients there, we get the value of mth iterative kernel in the form summation k varies from 1 to infinity phi k conjugate t into phi k s into lambda k raised to the power minus m, which is of the bilinear form, which we already obtained for the symmetric kernel k. So this is one of the consequences of Hilbert Smith theorem. If we take in particular s is equal to 2t in this form and integrate with respect to s, in that case from here by replacing t by s and integrating from a to b, the left side will become integral a to b km ss, and on the right side we have summation k varies from 1 to infinity lambda k raised to the power minus m integral phi k conjugate s into phi k s. Now because the sequence phi k is a sequence of orthonormal functions, so the norm of each function in that system, that is 1, so this will become 1, and so we get on the right side summation k varies from 1 to infinity lambda k raised to the power minus m, which is the trace of the iterative kernel km. Now next there are some definitions which will be used in the next theorem. First definition is what is non-negative definite kernel. If we have a symmetric square integrable kernel KST, then we say that the kernel is non-negative definite kernel if the inner product of K phi with phi is non-negative for every square integrable function phi. Next is positive definite kernel. In the positive definite kernel, in addition to this condition, we must have, if the inner product of K phi with phi is zero, then the function phi, that is null function. If in addition to that condition, this condition is satisfied, then we say that the kernel is positive definite kernel. Next is non-positive definite kernel. Suppose we have a symmetric square integrable kernel, KST, then we say that the kernel is non-positive definite if the inner product of K phi with phi, that is less than or equal to zero for every square integrable function phi. If in addition to this inner product of K phi is equal to zero implies that phi is null function, then we say that the kernel is negative definite kernel. If a symmetric kernel doesn't fall in any of the four categories, in that case it is called indefinite kernel. Now we will do the next theorem based on these definitions. So the theorem is, a non-null symmetric square integrable kernel is non-negative definite if and only if all its eigenvalues are positive. In order to prove this theorem, let us use Hilbert-Smith theorem. According to Hilbert-Smith theorem, if we have a function f which is represented in the form of k phi means integral kst phi dt, then the function can be expanded in absolutely and uniformly convergent Fourier series given by summation fn into phi ns, where phi ns is the system of the eigenfunctions, which is autonomous system, and fn are the Fourier coefficients of the function f given by hn upon lambda n, where hn are the Fourier coefficients of the function h. Now here, if we compare this form by the statement of Hilbert-Smith theorem, that function h is replaced by phi here, and so the Fourier coefficients of the function h, which are hn, they are given by inner product of phi with phi n. So this equation will become fs is equal to summation n varies from 1 to infinity inner product of phi with phi n into phi n divided by lambda n. Now because function f is represented by k phi, so substituting the value here we get the equation, and if we multiply this equation by phi conjugate and integrate with respect to s, the left side will become integral k phi into phi conjugate, and on the right side we have summation n varies from 1 to infinity inner product of phi with phi n into integration of phi n with phi conjugate divided by lambda n. Now by definition, this integral represents the inner product of function phi n with phi. Now by definition, z into z bar, that is z mod square, so this will become inner product of phi with phi n mod squared. So we have obtained the inner product of k phi with phi in the form summation n varies from 1 to infinity the square of mod of inner product of phi with phi n divided by lambda. Now if all the eigenvalues are positive, then from this equation we can see that this right hand side, that will be positive. So we can see that the inner product of k phi with phi, that is greater than or equal to zero, because this quantity can be greater than or equal to zero. These are positive, so this will be greater than or equal to zero. So this proves the first part. And conversely, let us take inner product of k phi with phi, that is greater than equal to 0. For every square integrable function phi, if any of the eigenvalues is negative, let us take lambda is negative, then by using k phi is equal to summation and varies from m varies from 1 to infinity, inner product of phi with phi m into phi m divided by lambda m. Let us replace phi by phi n here, and then taking the inner product of this with the function phi n. So from here we get inner product of k phi n with phi n is equal to summation m varies from 1 to infinity, inner product of phi n with phi m into inner product of phi m with phi n divided by lambda m. Again using the formula, because this is conjugate of this, so that will become square of mod. So inner product of k phi n with phi n, that becomes summation m varies from 1 to infinity, inner product of phi n with phi m mod square divided by lambda m. Now because the sequence phi n, that is a sequence of orthonormal functions, so by definition of orthonormal system, if these two suffixes they are different, then the inner product of the functions that will become 0, and if these two suffixes are same, in that case the inner product will become 1. So in this summation we are left only with one term, which will be corresponding to m is equal to n. So when m and n are same, this product will become 1. So we get inner product of k phi n with phi n is equal to 1 upon lambda n. Now because lambda n is negative, so we get inner product of k phi n with phi n, that is less than 0. But inner product is non-negative function, so we get a contradiction from here. So our assumption is wrong. So we can say that all the eigenvalues are positive. So we have proved that all the eigenvalues are positive for every value of n. And this completes the proof of this theorem.